When I was at art school, I discovered I was a bad painter, and that's how I kind of started doing performance work. But seriously, I've always been interested in the evolutionary architecture of the human body. I've always been envious of dancers, gymnasts, and singers who use their own body to both express and experience their artwork. You know, and as a performance artist, you have to take the physical consequences for your ideas. I've performed with a third hand, an extended arm, a six-legged walking robot. I designed a sculpture to be inserted into my stomach. And you have to imagine this sculpture, once it's inside the stomach cavity, as opening and closing, extending and retracting. It had a flashing light and a beeping sound. So it was a kind of machine choreography inside the human body. With the early suspension performances, there was police intervention. I got arrested for doing a performance over East 11th Street in New York. My body was hooked up, and the body comes out of a fourth floor story window, finishes halfway across the street. I had a good view of police cars that arrived in about 5 minutes. I was arrested not for public nudity, but rather for being a danger to the public. In other words, had I fallen on someone? My name is Stelarc, and I'm a performance artist, but I've always been interested in using technology in my performances and how that technology adjusts your operation and awareness in the world. I guess it's a general curiosity about what's possible, what's plausible, what pushes the boundaries. Determining, for example, the psychological and physiological parameters of the body, or how one can augment the physical body, the biological body, with prosthetic attachments or robotic extensions, or using instruments that enhance your sensory apparatus. That's the kind of approach that this particular artist takes. You know, we're increasingly expected to perform in mixed realities. We're still biological bodies, but increasingly we're accelerated by our machines, we're enhanced by our instruments, our computational capabilities are amplified with new technologies. So the body can be seen as a construct of meat, metal, and code. Well, there are already experiments done genetically meshing the DNA of plants, animals, and humans. So we're already doing experiments with that. Increasingly now, there's going to be a blurring of what's human, what's animal, what's robot. I've always been fascinated by the sort of the architecture of the ear. It's a very sort of beautiful architecture, and also it was a plausible body part to try to replicate. The idea, of course, is that we're going to surgically lift the helix to construct an ear flap. We're going to grow a soft earlobe using my adult stem cells, and then when everything is ready, we're going to reinsert a small microphone that used to be in there, and we're going to internet enable the ear by electronically augmenting it. So in any Wi-Fi hotspot, people anywhere will be able to go online and listen in to what my ear is hearing, wherever I am and wherever you are. The response to the ear on my arm has varied from people being repulsed by the idea of altering your body to fascination and curiosity about how it was done. One of the new developments in arts practice is bioart, and what's so seductive about that is, for example, that now sculptors can make living sculptures, or partially or semi-living, because of course these living cells have to be sustained in an incubator with nutrients So for me, what's interesting is that idea of making a sculpture not from inanimate matter, but rather making a sculpture that has living cells as its components.
It's hard to put a simple way of describing what biological arts is. From our perspective, it's basically any type of art that involves the direct manipulation of living systems as part of that practice. My interest is life. As an artist, I'm first and foremost, I'm interested in life. And it so happens that the most radical things that are going on with life at the moment happening in labs, and that's why I put myself in the lab. The sciences happen to be the most radical and the most thought-provoking instances in which life is now being kind of engaged with. So I think I want people to realize that something very, very strange is happening to life at the moment. The Victimless Leather was a very ironic piece. First of all, reminding people where original leather is coming from, but secondly, kind of looking at the ways in which our new technologies, rather than eliminating the victims, just pushing them ever so further that we don't even notice their existence. Our cultural perceptions of life are increasingly becoming incompatible with what we know about life through science, but even more importantly, what we choose to do to life through technologies. I think what's interesting with Stelak is that when he talks about this interface between humans and technologies, or between bodies and technologies, they're never seamless. They always seem to be painful. There's no moment when you can say, this is really connecting well. Or when I talk to him, he says that he always tried to achieve those seamless moments, but it seems that in the performance, in his art, those contestable moments, those moments where things are actually not matching, are what I find the most interesting. And is, I think, to a large extent, he's a prophet in the sense of his, and he's willing to put his body, his very personal body, on the line.
So we're no longer really about evolutionary change or natural selection, but rather in technological modification, augmentation, amplification, and acceleration of change. So evolution is something that changes very slowly. In the realm of the human now, with technology, we change much more quickly. With new means of giving birth and ways of delaying death, we can have a situation where in the future you'll neither be born nor will you necessarily die. So for example, the possibilities of engineering artificial wombs. Now, if you are brought to bear in an artificial womb, then you won't be born as such. And if we can replace malfunctioning organs with replaceable parts, there's no necessity for you to die. So all of a sudden, we have to redefine a human existence. Human existence doesn't necessarily begin in birth, doesn't necessarily end in death.